What is it that shapes your understanding of God? What is it that has shaped and is shaping your understanding of God? Is it the Bible, or is it our culture? Now think about that for a minute. Is your understanding of God shaped and developed by what you read in the Scriptures, or is it more shaped and developed by our culture and what you would like Him to be? I would hope the answer is the Scripture, but for far too many Christians, the answer would be our culture or what I would like Him to be. You ever hear someone say, well, I just couldn't serve a God like that? Well, they probably can't. But that doesn't change who God is. But far too many Christians today have what I call an Epicurean view of God. And if you're not acquainted with Epicurus, he was a Greek philosopher, and he lived in 341 to 270 BC. He actually, before Christ. But Epicurus had an interesting philosophy, and what he said in a nutshell was this: pleasure and pain are the measures of good and evil. Pleasure and pain are the measures of good and evil. Now, it's interesting to me how we buy into that. Because do we not just sort of automatically equate things that are good with God and things that are evil with Satan? Or things that are pleasurable with God, things that are painful with Satan? That's why when we come to verses like John 4:8, we've talked about that, where God, it says, God is love. We sort of flip it around, sometimes totally unconsciously, and say love is God. And so we take our view of love, what we think love is, and we project that onto God, and we say that's what God's like. So in our view of love, if we had the power, our loved ones would never feel pain, would they? If you could raise your children and have them never break an arm, never get the flu, you would do it, as I would do it. So we think then that God, if He is our Heavenly Father, and He has the power, which He does, then nothing should ever afflict us. Right? Okay. And who would that come from? No other than our friend Epicurus. Here's how he developed that. If God is willing to prevent evil but is not able to, then He is not omnipotent, all-powerful. If He is able but not willing, then He is malevolent, evil. If He is both able and willing, then whence cometh evil? If He neither able nor willing, then why call Him God? Now, you've all heard that come from people. They paraphrase it. You know, they say, if God is all-powerful, why does He permit evil? If He loves us. And if He permits evil, then He must not love us, or He must not be all-powerful. You hear that argument made all the time. But Christians often make that same argument, though not in those words. And I would suggest to you that this stems from a profound misunderstanding of just who God is. And that's what we're going to find out as we go through this book of Revelation, isn't it? It's God revealing Himself to us. Now, unfortunately, modern evangelicalism, that's us and the Methodists and the Lutherans and all the independent churches, you know, on and on, etc. Modern evangelicalism has not help much in this area. Think back, if you were raised in church, if you remember, if you went through the Sunday school stuff, think of the pictures and how Jesus was portrayed to you the vast majority of the time. He was sort of this pale, limp-wristed guy with maybe he'd have a lamb around his neck, or maybe he'd be playing with some children. And those were true depictions of Him, but they were very one-sided. They weren't balanced with the picture of the conquering king, you see. And remember, when John looked, and what did he see? He saw a lion. And then he looked again, and he saw a lamb. both the lion and the lamb. Now, we've done this with good intentions. We pastors have exacerbated the problem. We had good intentions, but we have often preached what one might call a fairy godmother savior or a Mr. Fix-It savior. How many sermons have you heard about if you'll just take Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, He'll cure your addiction, or He'll be the savior of your marriage, or He'll be the savior of your financial problems? Now, we may not pose it quite that overtly, but that's what we often say, we being evangelicalism. I hope I don't do that. But what happens when we do that? We give people a fairy tale view of Jesus Christ and what it means to serve Him. Why is it that fairy tales are so popular? Because they always have a happy ending. But in life, and the things we go through in life, we don't always have happy endings. And if we have told people, if you only accept Jesus, you'll always have a happy ending, then when that doesn't happen, what do? They walk away. You see? We should not do that. Jesus is neither Mr. Fix-It nor our fairy godmother. He's our God and our Lord. What we have done is, we have created a bunch of limp-wristed, namby-pamby Christians. And the first time they have problems or they have tribulation, what do? They cut and run. And believe me, if you're married, there's going to be some tribulation. If you're employed with somebody, there's going to be some tribulation from time to time. If you're a member of a church, there's going to be some tribulation. Now, if you cut and run every time there's some tribulation, you're never going to get anything worked through. So what we have to be able to do, we have to understand that Jesus Himself said, in this world you will have what? Tribulation. But be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. Now, there'll become a time when we're out of here and we won't have that. But what we've done is, we have sold Christianity, if we can use that term, on the basis of, in the here and now, it's going to fix all your problems. When we don't need a Savior to fix our marriage. We don't need a Savior to kick our addiction. And we don't need a Savior to fix our financial problems. And I'm not saying He can't help, but I'm saying this, there have been many, many people on this earth who don't know Jesus Christ from the Easter Bunny that have kicked their addictions, that have worked through their marital problems, that have worked through their financial problems. We need Jesus as our Savior from hell. And we don't like to talk about that. I don't like to talk about that. It's much easier to preach the nice, loving Savior than it is to preach the conquering King who comes in judgment upon the world. But it's a fact. And the fact is, there's no way we can save ourselves because we're spiritually dead. So we need a Savior, not to fix us, not to fix our problems, but to save us from an eternity in hell. What we have done is, we have taken the gospel and made it applicable to the here and now when it is applicable to eternity. And we need to be just a little more honest about it, a little more biblical about it. Which brings us to the purpose of our study of Revelation. Now, you heard Bill tell us about those horses. That was uplifting, wasn't it? Yeah. Kind of went from bad to worse, didn't it? Well, that's life. It's scary. Indeed it is. Dennis Johnson, who wrote what I consider to be one of the better commentaries on the book of Revelation and referring to this, addresses one of the problems we have in interpreting the book of Revelation. He says, the experience of the disciples themselves shows that when we get into the Bible's teaching about things to come, it is easier to ask the wrong question than the right one. We want to ask when. Jesus is more interested in answering who and why. And that's what we do, isn't it? We want to know when. Well, if the apostles themselves asked the wrong question, we shouldn't be too hard on ourselves for doing the same thing. I mean, these guys ate and slept with Jesus, and they still asked the wrong question. So you can't blame us too much for asking the wrong question, but we're trying to kick that habit, and as we work through this, I hope we do. Now, I'm going to refer a lot to Matthew chapter 24 this morning, because Jesus is telling about what's going to happen in the future from that time, okay? Matthew 24 is called the Olivet Discourse, and if you've never studied it, it's a great piece to study, and you can't really understand Revelation if you don't understand Matthew 24. It's also in Luke 21 and Mark 13. It's not in John's Gospel. And if you want to get a book about this, probably the best book out there on Matthew 24 is End Times According to Jesus. And it's R.C. Sproul. It's a great book. And if you've never read it, it's a good one to read. But Matthew 24, to set it up, I'll just read here for you, verse 2 of 24. I'll start in verse 1. Jesus left the temple and was going away when his disciples came to point out to him the buildings of the temple. But he answered them, "You see all these, do you not? Truly I say to you, there will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down." Now that would have literally floored the apostles, that statement. Now to us, it doesn't mean a whole lot, because we don't grasp what the temple looked like. We don't grasp. It's like the destruction of Jerusalem and the destruction of the temple in AD 70, which was the end of the era, the end of the Jewish era. It was done. We don't grasp that there were more Jews killed in the destruction of that temple in a few months' time than Hitler ever thought about killing. We think about the Holocaust, but all the 6 million Jews, that was terrible, that was awful, and it was. But we think about the destruction of the temple, and we think it may be something the size of this church, or maybe something the size of a big Mormon temple somewhere. But this thing was huge. This was a literal city within a city. And so when Jesus pointed to these stones and said, not one will be left on another, this was unimaginable to these people. And for one thing, just the size of them. Now, what do you think about when you think about a building built with stones? Maybe stones that size, or maybe some bigger ones, or whatever. Let me tell you how big these stones were. These walls were 9 stories high. Okay? Now, they were 16 feet thick. This is a huge thing. Many of the stones weighed over 100 tons. Some of them as large as 11 by 16, weighing 567 to 628 tons. Now that's not what you think about when you think of stones, is it? We miss the magnitude of this thing. And that's why Jesus got in so much trouble when he said, destroy this temple and I'll rebuild it in 3 days. He was talking about his body, of course, but they thought he was talking about the temple. This is impossible. So this thing was huge. These guys are just dumbfounded by what he said. So, we come to verse 3. As he sat on the Mount of Olives, thus we get the name the Olivet Discourse, the disciples came to him privately saying, tell us, when will these things be? And what will be the sign of your coming? So what's the first thing they want to know? When? They want time. And isn't that what has been done with the book of Revelation so often? People go there not to find out what God is like, but to find out when. To find out a time frame. Well, the apostles must surely have been frustrated by his reply. They wanted a clear-cut calendar. They wanted to know the symptoms. They wanted to know when this was going to be. If you read through the Gospels, one thing that has to get your attention is Jesus is a master at not answering the questions he's asked by various individuals. You ever notice that? He cuts right to the heart of the matter, oftentimes completely ignoring their question. The same holds true here. They wanted an answer about time. He gave them a glimpse of terrifying trends. Now get this part. That were not signs of the end, but symptoms of this fallen world, sinful estate. You've got to get that. What Jesus says on the Mount of Olives, what we're reading, what Bill read for us this morning, are not things that are going to happen at the end, but things that are going to happen all throughout this fallen, sinful world. They are the beginning of judgment. They aren't the final judgment. And I'll develop that for you here as we go along. Now, Jesus in the Olivet Discourse, as we will do as we go through this book of Revelation, makes distinction between his judgment on the Jews in AD 70 and the coming judgment at the end of the world, the end of time. He makes distinction, as we must make distinction, between what is history, what is simply happening in the course of life, and what will happen when he returns. If we try to take and read the book of Revelation or the Olivet Discourse and say, it's all future, we're going to miss a big chunk of it. If we say, it's all contemporary, we're going to miss some of it. And if we say, it's all past, we're going to miss some of it. And those are actually three theological schools of thought, school ways to approach the book of Revelation. There are some folks that say, the whole thing has already happened. We call them preterists. And then there are some folks that say, well, yes, yeah, some of it has happened, some of it is happening, some of it is yet future. We call them partial preterists. And then there are some people that say the whole thing is future, and we call them futurists. Now, I gave you a real simplistic, you know, there's a lot of books written on this, but that's a simplistic way to understand it, okay? And there's nothing wrong with simple. I like simple. What's interesting here is, even after the resurrection, the apostle still asks the wrong question. In Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 8. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of heaven? When? That's the question. Will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. So again they ask, when? Are you going to restore the kingdom of Israel now? And his reply is, not for you to know when. You need to get about my business. Isn't that just like us? So often we ask when we could just be getting on with the business of carrying out God's plan. So let's look and see what we can see in our chapter 6 here of Revelation about what God is trying to reveal to us about himself here, because that's what he's doing, right? So Jesus, lion or lamb. You remember in Revelation 5, verses 5 and 6? And one of the elders said to me, weep no more. Behold, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals. And between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb. There we have the lion and we have the lamb. Both symbolizing Jesus Christ. The problem is, Christianity in general is quick to embrace the lamb. We love the lamb. What's not to love about the lamb? He's cuddly and cute and kind and sweet and all that stuff. We love the lamb. But if you read on in Revelation 5, this is a little different kind of lamb, isn't it? Remember the seven horns and the seven eyes and, oh, a little different. The fact of the matter is, he is both lamb and lion. He is equally both. Well, you say, what about, you're saying the lion is going to return to judge people, to judge the earth? Yeah. The lamb came as the savior, the lion's coming as the judge. You say, well, wait a minute, what about John 3:17? God did not send his son into the world to judge the world, but to save it. That's exactly right. That was his first coming, and he came as the suffering servant. We read about in Isaiah 53. He came as the lamb that went to slaughter, the one sacrifice for all time to end all sacrifices. Yes. But you notice, the vast majority of the world missed the fact that he came as their savior because they were looking for who? The lion. Remember? The Pharisees, the Jewish nation, they were looking for the Messiah to come, overthrow the Romans, set up the kingdom of Israel, and rule from then on. And they totally missed it because he came as the lamb. Now, what if we're looking for him to come back as a lamb? We're in trouble. Because when he comes back the second time, he's coming as the lion. He's coming as the judge. And that's not going to be good for some folks. That's one of the reasons for this book of Revelation. So we can know how he's coming back. Well, what about these four horsemen? What do they have to do with anything? Well, this isn't the first time they show up, and if you're really going to study Revelation, you have to study the whole Bible. You have to start with the Old Testament, and it can be pretty laborious. But if you read the book of Zechariah, guess what you'll find in there? Four horsemen. Now, they're not identical, but they're very close. See? Well, what about these four horsemen? The first one is the most interesting and most controversial one. We'll talk about him for a minute. But before we do, let's talk about the voice that summons John to look. And what is it? In verse 1, "Now I watched when the Lamb opened one of the seven seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures say with a voice like thunder, 'Come!'" That's not a lamb thing, is it? He didn't say, "Well, John, if you don't mind, come on in here." No. With a voice like thunder, it's "Come!" "Oh, okay, I'm coming." Yeah. No lamb here. "Now the first horse, I looked and behold a white horse, and its rider had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he came out conquering and to conquer." Whoa. Well, who is this rider on this white horse? Well, the theological world is divided. Some say, well, this is Christ, because when we get to Revelation 19, we're going to find Christ coming on a white horse. Okay? So they say, okay, white horse, yeah, and he's got a crown, right? Right here he's got a crown. It must be Jesus. I don't think so. I tend to side with the other group. And why would I not think so? Well, because he's not talking here about when he comes at the end. He's talking here about judgment that has already begun on a fallen, sinful world. And the white horse is, in their culture, was a symbol of a victorious conqueror. If you were the head of a legion and you had gone out and you had done well in battle, whether the battle horse you rode was white or not, when you entered the city, when you came into Rome, you rode in on a white horse, because you had killed a lot of people. That's what it kind of boils down to. But you say, but he has a crown. Ah, he has a crown. But Greek has a couple of words for crown. They're totally different. Stephanos is a crown. Diadem is a crown. You remember the elders and the creatures and the folks cast their crowns down before the Lord? Those were Stephanos crowns. By the way, if your name's Stephen, that's what it means in Greek, crown. The rider on this horse has a Stephanos crown. The rider on the horse in Revelation 19 has a diadem crown. Totally different. One is a crown like you would give someone for distinguishing themselves in service, for someone who is a ruler over a certain part of the kingdom. The other is the crown that's reserved for the king alone. So I think this is not Jesus. I think this is exactly what it says it is. It's someone coming to conquer. And how do you conquer? That's not a safe word, is it? That's a hard word. That's a harsh word. When you conquer somebody, you don't come up to the edge of their border and say, I'd like you guys to take a vote and vote me in as your ruler. No, you bring your army and you kill a lot of people. I think that's what this first writer is all about. Matthew 24, verse 6. Now Jesus is explaining what's going to happen to his apostles. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not alarmed, for this must take place. Now catch it. But the end is not yet. Now how many of you have heard of wars and rumors of wars? Everyone. Since you were big enough to understand. And how long have wars and rumors of wars been going on? Since the fall. Cain slew Abel, and away we go. Been downhill ever since. So wars and rumors of wars, as some read the Olivet Discourse, say this cannot be the end. This is the here and now. This is the beginning of the birth pangs, as Jesus puts it later. So I think that's who the first horse represents. Because we see it all around us. Well, then he opens the second seal. Verses 5. Then he opened the second seal. I heard the second living creature say, come. And out came another horse, bright red. Its rider was permitted to take peace from the earth so that people should slay one another. And he was given a great sword. In Jesus' words, Matthew 24, verse 7, for nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. And there you go. A little different phraseology. Jesus is giving them a verbal description. We're getting a pictorial description. But it's the same thing. I cannot recall, and I could be wrong, but I doubt it. I cannot recall a single day in history where there haven't been killing each other somewhere on this earth. And if you can and document it, please let me know. But they cry, peace, peace, and what do we get? War, war. Ever since the fall. The third seal in verses 5 and 6. When he opened the third seal, I heard the third creature say, come. And I looked, and behold, a black horse, and its rider had a pair of scales in his hand. And I heard what seemed to be a voice in the midst of the four living creatures saying, a quart of wheat for a denarius, three quarts of barley for a denarius, and do not harm the oil or the wine. Now, we don't have time to go into all the details of that, but let's hear Jesus explain it. And there will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are but the beginning of birth pangs. So we have conquerors, we have wars, we have famines, we have earthquakes. Now, the famine is another word we don't get. Unless you've traveled to some other places in this world, you don't get famine at all. You get it intellectually, but you don't get it emotionally. Because God has blessed us and allowed us to live in this blessed country. Well, we don't have, you know, there's not a person in this room that's ever even experienced real hunger pains. You know, our tummy growls a little bit and we feed it. We get hungry if we go, you know, I can't eat anything after midnight and I'm already stressed. You know, before this surgery thing, because there's going to be a few hours there where I can't eat. Can't have my coffee. Oh, how awful. Woe is me. But when he talks about famine, now, we get it a little better now because of television, we see the pictures and things, you know, but thousands and thousands and millions of people die from famine all the time. So this can't be the sign of the end because it's been going on since the beginning. And then the fourth seal. When he opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of the fourth living creature say, "Come," and I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and on its rider's name was Death, and Hades followed after him. Wow. Wow. What is the logical consequence of the desire to conquer, which leads to war, which leads to famine, which leads to death? That's what we're going to have to put up with as long as we're here on this earth. So what Jesus is saying is, and you got to remember who's sending these horsemen. It's not the Satan, it's Jesus. These are the beginnings of judgment on his enemies. And unfortunately, we suffer from the residual. All these people now have died, which leads us, quite conveniently, to the fifth seal. Now the vision shifts from earth to heaven. You've got to be able to make these shifts as you go through prophetic literature. The fifth seal, we now move to a scene in heaven. And here's what we find. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the witness they had borne. They cried out with a loud voice, "O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long?" Still asking the wrong question, aren't they? "How long before you will judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth?" Then they were each given a white robe and told to rest a little longer until the number of their fellow servants and their brothers should be complete, who were to be killed as they themselves had been killed. That's Jesus talking. Now, probably, I would like to say some of us may have to die before the end comes for the cause of Christ. But we probably won't, again, because he has blessed us to live in a place where that doesn't happen too often. But there are places, you read about it in the paper all the time, where people are killed every day for their faith in Jesus Christ. Now the scene in heaven is, there they are, to be absent from the bodies, to be present with the Lord. And they're asking God, "When are you going to bring this thing to an end? When are you going to stop it?" And he simply says, "Not yet. Not yet." There's some interesting things about these martyrs. As we see typical prophetic language going on here. Three things particularly. They have white robes, and white robes are indicative of, again, victory. Notice these guys have conquered. They've been given their white robes because they endured to the end. No time period again is given, and more will be killed. What can we expect as long as we live on this earth? More of the same. In this world, you will have tribulation. Now, in 12 through 17, we are introduced to some cataclysmic events. And they're quite amazing. Now again, think about what we could do with this with some good special effects, some good TV. When he opened the sixth seal, I looked, and behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth, and the full moon became like blood, and the stars of the sky fell to the earth as the fig tree sheds its winter fruit when shaken by a gale. The sky vanished like a scroll that is being rolled up, and every mountain and island was removed from its place. Then the kings of the earth and the great ones of the generals and the rich and the powerful and everyone, slave and free, hid themselves in the caves and among the rocks and the mountains, calling out to the mountains, "Fall on us and hide us from the face of him who is seated on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of their wrath has come, and who can stand?" Quite a scene, isn't it? If you read Matthew chapter 24, you will find Jesus using some of the same terminology. God told the martyrs to wait. He gave them an indefinite period of time. But now he assures John and the martyrs that the end will come. There will be a climax to this whole thing. It will come certainly, and it will come suddenly. And as I say, you can read Jesus' depiction in verses 29 through 31 of Matthew 24. Now, this is typical prophetic language, isn't it? We've seen this many times. Now, you read, go back to the prophets when they're prophesying the destruction of Jerusalem and that early on, they use this same kind of language. So it's hard to tell. We can't really pin it down exactly whether this is literal or figurative. But here's what we do know. It's going to be a heck of a day, one way or another. And at the end, they say, who can stand? We touched on it last week. When Christ returns again, every knee will bow of those who are in heaven, those who are on the earth, those who are under the earth, and every tongue will confess Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Now that includes everyone. Some will bow before their loving heavenly Savior and confess Him as Lord with a joy I just can't imagine. Some will bow in terror before their judge, and I can't imagine that either. The difference is whether He is your Savior or your judge. And it all depends on what you do in the here and now. The bottom line, in this world, you'll have tribulation. But God is coming back. Jesus is coming back. And if you know Him as your Lord and Savior, it's going to be a glorious day and a glorious time. No more tribulation, no more crying, no more tears, all that stuff. All of a sudden, we get to actually be Epicureans because it's all going to be good. If you don't know Him as your Lord and Savior, and if you're here today and you don't know Him as your Lord and Savior, now is the time. Because we don't know. We don't know. God could wait another 2,000 years before He comes back, or He could come back before we get out of this building. We don't know. So I would encourage you, make that decision. Make sure Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior. You do that by simply bowing before Him figuratively and saying, yes, Lord, I need a Savior. Not to save my marriage, not to save my addiction, not to save whatever, but to save my soul from burning in hell. The one thing I cannot do. Jesus is returning. How will you react? Who can stand before Him? Those who He calls His sons and daughters. No one else. So as we go to communion this morning, I would encourage you as we take a minute to reflect, think about that. Yeah, Jesus helps us all the time in all kinds of situations, and He may help us with our everyday trials and struggles. But we need a Savior, not a helper. And He saved us from the pit of hell. For that, we can be thankful. For that, we can have gratitude. And I don't like preaching these kinds of sermons, but they need to be preached from time to time because we need to understand how much we owe Him in gratitude. You know, Jonathan Edwards' famous sermon, Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. If you've never read it, you should read it. It's on the internet. It's only a little short sermon. Awesome. Awesome sermon. And that's where we're at. We're sinners in the hands of an angry God, and we need a Savior to make us saints in the eyes of a loving God. Make the right choice. Okay? Lord, thank You. Thank You that You are the loving Savior that we all need. But thank You also that You are the conquering judge who will one day make things right. You've said it in Your word that judgment will come. And Lord, it's not something that we delight in at all. We wish it could be different. But yet we know Your plan is perfect, that You are God, and no one, according to the book of Daniel, can say to you, what have you done? Or stay your hand, because you are God. And because of that, we bow before you. In your name, Jesus. Amen.